Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night, and Merry Christmas. Here we are, live now on YouTube, and it is raining. We were going to go for a lovely walk, but unfortunately, if you look carefully, you can see it is raining at the moment. So we have under the gazebo in the garden. So we are staying nice and dry. I'm not sure about anything else there because it's raining quite a lot. And of course, joining me, Mr. Steve is here as well. But I know what you're asking. You're asking, where are you, Mr. Duncan? We can't see you. We can't see your beautiful, handsome face. We can't see your dashing style. Well, wait no longer, because it's not just me, it's someone else as well. Hi, everybody. This is Mr. Duncan and
Mr. Steve.
Mr. Steve is here as well. We are nice and dry under my little gazebo in the garden. And I have to say, we did have a couple of plans for today. Both of them now are not happening, but we are at least live with you on YouTube. We've managed to do that, at least, Mr. Steve.
Yes, we were going to go for a walk and then do a live stream on Mr. Duncan's mobile, and just for something different. But the forecast changed and it was supposed to rain later on. Then it started raining, so we had to quickly set up outside.
It's been raining for 2 hours now, literally 2 hours without stopping. So we thought, well, that's it really, that's it. We're going to have to make another plan. So this is plan, it's not plan B, this is plan, I think it might be plan W, because we had lots of different plans. By the way, did you see us yesterday? Did you see Mr. Steve? I can't believe yesterday, Mr. Steve, you were driving along the country lanes and you were sounding your horn. I know what you're going to say. You're going to say, well, there was no one around, but still, it was so funny.
Well, I guess, well, you know, I like to mess around. It was safe. It was all very safe, Mr. Duncan.
It was.
But I was imitating or pretending that I was undergoing a bit of road rage.
Yes.
Road rage.
It is common here.
Which sometimes I do for real if somebody crosses me on the open road. But I was just pretending for comic effect, and it was all very safe, and no one was injured. We were just having a bit of fun.
And we had to have some fun yesterday, because we went to see Mr. Steve's sister and brother-in-law. We had a lovely meal. I want to say lovely, but it wasn't the best meal. And we're not talking about the company we were in.
Oh.
We were having a lovely time with your sister and brother-in-law, but the meal wasn't that good, was it? It was very, 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 what's the word I'm looking for? I want to say it was a little bit bland.
Below average. You know when you go to a restaurant and it all looks very nice, all looks very posh, the outside looks nice, the service is very good,
yes.
The setting is lovely, expensive decor, but then the food is below average.
Mm-hmm.
So we were a little disappointed with the food, but we had a nice time anyway. But the food really is the main thing, isn't it? When you go to a restaurant, you want the food to be good. If the food is good, you forgive everything.
Mm.
You'll even forgive bad service if the food is good.
Yes, that is the top thing. Two things you expect when you go for a meal. The food has to be good and the service has to be fast. Those are the top two things. The rest of it is, to me, anyway, it's secondary.
Yes, but anyway, we had a nice time.
Mm.
We're not here for long. We ought to say, oughtn't we, Mr. Duncan?
Well,
what's your plan?
Well, as I've mentioned just before we came on, I think we will just do maybe half an hour. We will see what happens. We will see how many of you lovely students and viewers around the world, how many people are here joining us, because they might have other things to do, you see. Not only us. Not only us with our busy lives, but you. You might have a busy life as well.
Yes, we'd like to know what you're doing, as ever. Every week, a number of you are, as we are doing the live stream, you are also doing your own thing. Sometimes it's ironing.
I know.
One cooking.
Can I just say one thing? Claudia is busy today because she's doing some special things. I think it's a birthday party for her brother.
How lovely.
So she's made a lovely cake as well. She sent me a picture. Thank you, Claudia, for the photograph of your cake. I know it has nuts.
I haven't seen the picture of the cake, Mr. Duncan. You'll have to show me later.
It has nuts.
You're not keen on nuts, are you?
I don't like nuts. I don't like nuts.
No, but I do. I scoff them down. Scoff. If you scoff something down, S-C-O-F-F.
Do you want to lie down, Steve?
I'm fine. I'm just relaxing, Mr. Duncan.
You're disappearing on the screen.
Mr. Duncan, just relaxing.
This is what Steve is doing now.
As I was trying to actually, you know, do a bit of teaching. Scoff. If you scoff something down, S-C-O-F-F, I think it's pronounced or spelt, it means you eat something very quickly. You probably don't chew it properly. Because you're so hungry or you like it so much. Do you often do that when you have a meal out somewhere, or if you're eating at home, you scoff the food down? It means you eat it very quickly, probably too quickly, you don't chew it enough, you might get indigestion later, but usually if you're very hungry, you will scoff your food down and you might be criticised by your loved ones, particularly if you're a child.
Yes. When you say loved ones, do you mean people who are a member of your family or maybe someone you have recently done this with? So let's have a look at your lovely ring, Mr. Steve.
I'm leaning, Mr. Duncan. I'm leaning here. I cannot possibly remove my hand.
Can I just say?
Otherwise, I will fall over.
Steve is not wearing his ring. I am. I'm wearing mine, but Steve is not. He keeps forgetting. How do you forget? What are you doing down there, Steve? Is it my birthday already?
There we go, Mr. Duncan. I have it on. I have my ring on.
Yes.
And just to show everybody that this is by all means, this is not just a bit of wire that I've just wrapped around my finger and found in Mr. Duncan's little toolbox down there. This is, in fact, the real ring. It's falling apart already. We need to get our money back.
Yes. Well, this is the real ring. And Steve keeps forgetting.
I do keep forgetting to put it on. Well, strange enough...
How do you forget?
Well, this is an interesting question to you who have been married.
They've been married? Well,
let me finish the sentence.
If you've been married...
To those of you who have been married for a long period of time... So we were with, I'm sure my sister won't mind me revealing this bit of information about their relationship.
It's up to you.
My sister said that she has never taken her wedding ring off. They've been married for 30-something years. And I think her husband also said the same thing, have never taken their wedding rings off. So not for washing, showering, doing the housework, going to sleep. How about you? So if you are married and you've got a wedding ring, do you ever take it off? Do you take it off at night? Do you take it off when you're doing the garden? See, I like to take it off when I'm doing things like gardening because I think it's not safe.
Yes, anyway.
You get caught up in equipment.
What I want to actually mention, Steve...
Well, anyway, that's my question. Do you take your wedding ring off or do you keep it on all the time?
That's it.
I thought it was an interesting thing.
It is an interesting question. Hmm. So do you ever take it off? Although Mr. Steve never puts it on.
That's true. So it's always off. No, I do put it on. But the thing is, we've been together for 34 years. It's difficult. I don't wear my wedding ring. I don't know. I stopped wearing it. Yes, Olga doesn't wear her wedding. Wedding ring. That's difficult to say.
Wedding ring.
At all. So that's well, so therefore, Mr. Duncan, I don't have to wear mine.
I tell you what happens. Okay, Steve, you have to stop sometime. Yeah, what happens with these things is they are very good if you want to get your own way, because all you have to do is start to take this off and say, look, this can come off at any moment, or maybe even throw it at the other person.
Palmyra doesn't wear her rings because I do find them. If you're not used to having, I've never liked wearing jewellery of any description. Why are you doing that? Standing over there, Mr. Duncan.
Go on.
I've never liked wearing any form of jewellery, necklaces, bracelets, rings. I just find them irritating. I'm conscious of them all the time. So I'm always, when I've got the ring on, I'm always fiddling with it. And I've never liked bracelets. They just annoy me. I must be very sensitive skin, Mr. Duncan. There we go. So that's interesting. Some people saying that they don't wear their... Well, maybe, yeah, yes. Maybe you don't wear your wedding ring because you want to meet another man. Maybe you don't want people to know you're married.
Yes. Is that the reason why you don't wear it?
Well, because, you know, I want to be seen as available at all times, Mr. Duncan.
That's it. Well, this is it. I think everyone knows you are available. It's just
there we go. Look what Olga has said.
Yes?
Olga said her husband stopped wearing his wedding ring because he nearly broke his finger while working. Now,
Are we going to tell the story
again? We're
going
to tell the story very briefly. There are lots of accidents with people wearing wedding rings. My best friend at work, her husband was playing tennis.
Yes.
Doing a backhand against the net, and his wedding ring got caught in the net and it literally tore his finger right off.
That's it.
I've told this story before, but I know of other people where it's happened. Similar thing has happened. You can get it caught up in equipment. So that's why, you know, safety, take it off. My marriage ring was lost, says, what do I do? Where do I tap? Lewis lost his marriage ring, bought another one, and then I think he lost that one as well. But because he said he gets distracted, it's a small thing, it's easy to lose. I don't want to lose ours.
You don't lose it when you never put it on.
That's true, it could fall down the back of the bed maybe.
Of course, the most painful part of having a wedding ring is actually putting it on for the first time during the wedding ceremony.
Yeah, you couldn't get mine on, could you, Mr. Duncan?
No, I meant just you don't want to do it.
I've got quite big knuckles. My sister said yesterday that she doesn't know if she could actually take it off because it's been on for 30 years. Maybe her knuckles have got bigger or her fingers have got fatter. No, probably not, because she does look after herself, my sister.
Yes, what is it?
But yes, if you keep it on all the time, maybe you need some grease, a bit of butter to get it off with. Interesting that, most people so far have said that they take their rings off or don't even wear them at all.
I find that a little... I have to say, I'm disappointed, to be honest. I'm very disappointed because I wear mine all the time, even when I'm having a poop.
You don't wear it at night, though, do you?
I don't wear it at night, just in case the ring fairy comes and takes it away.
You're thinking of the tooth fairy, Mr. Duncan, tooth fairy.
Oh, okay.
That you put your children used to take their teeth fell out, their milk teeth, as we call them, their first teeth fall out. That's an interesting thing, whether that happens in other countries. In the UK,
mm-hmm.
My mother used to say, oh, so a tooth fell out when I was, say, six. When do your second teeth come through?
I have no idea.
Oh, anyway, so the old ones fall out, don't they? The milk teeth, as we call them. And then my mother used to say, put the tooth under your pillow and the tooth fairy will come and take it away. Mm. And then there will be a little surprise for you, like money.
Are you sure you weren't the tooth fairy?
Well, that's the thing. I think what happened is I think my mother said the wrong thing.
Mm-hmm.
And, the tooth fairy turned me into a fairy.
Do you like my really awkward way, my awkward way of holding the microphone? I think this will catch on. This will be the new social media trend. everyone holding their microphone in a very strange way.
It'll get you noticed for a few minutes, Mr. Duncan. So yeah. Any more stories about wedding rings? Anybody there who has sustained an injury as a result of their wedding ring?
Or if you've lost it, what is the strangest place you've ever lost your wedding ring? Maybe when you were sitting on a toilet, maybe you were attending to yourself, and then the ring fell off into the toilet.
See, I'm thinking that if you take the wedding ring off, people might think you are available for a relationship.
Yes.
But on the other hand, it could work the other way, because if you keep your wedding ring on, some people might say, ooh, they are marriage-worthy, someone. They must be very good in a relationship or good in bed or something.
Okay.
Because somebody has decided to marry them. So you might become more attractive with the ring on. Whereas without a ring, if you're a certain age, say you're in your 40s or 50s, somebody might think, blimey, they've got to 40 or 50 and nobody's married them. They can't be very good.
Mm.
So I won't ask them out.
I know there was a trend in the 1990s, where if you wore a wedding ring, actually had one on, you were seen as hot property and people would try to get you.
Exactly. Try and chat you up, because you must have some attributes, some qualities that make you worthy of marriage.
You've already been pre-approved.
Exactly. So, well, strange. It's amazing how people notice things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I went to see a friend who I've known for 40 years.
Is this the mad one?
40 years. They're all mad. All my friends are mad, including myself. And I went to see him, and we just went to a restaurant for a meal, Chinese meal. And so I was wearing my wedding ring, and he noticed.
Yes.
Now, I wouldn't have thought that would have been something you'd notice. I never notice people's rings. Do you, Mr. Duncan? Well, not their wedding rings, anyway. But I don't notice. I don't look at people's hands to see if they're married. Do you? I think some people do.
Well, quite often you notice them just because they glint. They have a certain glint in the light.
A shine.
Yes.
That the gold in your wedding ring, Mr. Duncan, as in all gold, has been formed from a supernova explosion billions of years ago. A star going into supernova, creating that particular element, gold, which is a heavy element, and it has sent it flying through the galaxy and ended up on Earth.
On my finger.
Yes, there's only one place that gold can be made, and that's in an exploding star. That's quite amazing.
I think. We need more of them.
Along with lots of the heavy elements.
So I would imagine when our sun explodes in around about 500 million years from now, I suppose there would be lots of gold around. Ooh, I can't wait for that.
Well, you see, our sun is very small, so apparently, according to the experts, it won't ever go into supernova.
Oh.
It's too small. It will, I think it expands and gets bigger, so that's not going to happen to our sun. You need a particularly massive...
It becomes a red dwarf, doesn't it?
Yes, I think so, something like that.
It goes really big, and in doing so, the Earth will be evaporated.
Consumed.
Isn't that good?
Consumed.
So all that work, all that trouble that we're going to try and save the planet, it's all pointless, because eventually the sun is going to expand and we will be obliterated.
How do I get the live chat, Mr. Duncan?
Well, remember the rule?
Tap somewhere, anywhere. Nothing's happening.
It's
there we go.
Swipe. Don't
swipe. Palmyra, there's
swipe.
An interesting comment.
Here's the rule. I'm going to say it once today. Swipe.
Can I swipe down?
Swipe, don't tap.
I noticed in some countries, says Palmyra, men wear their wedding rings today, on their left hand. Whereas in where Palmyra is, the country, the people wear it on the right hand. Well, yes, we wear it on the left in England. I'm not sure about... the rest of Europe.
Some have it through their nose.
And in other places as well. Somebody's already alluded to that.
Okay.
I have similar type of ring, says Olga. Yes, the traditional gold band. It's a very popular, they call it a gold band in the UK. It's a particularly common wedding ring style.
There's some brilliant comments coming up. Francesca just said, I only notice the wedding ring when I like the person who is wearing it. And then Francesca deleted the message.
Well, she didn't want her husband to see it.
Mm. So your secret is out now.
Of course, we're not going to go into that. Yes, exactly. You don't want to be noticed as somebody who is maybe, what do they call a woman that is always trying to go after married men? There is a name for that.
Slut? Sorry?
Is that what you're saying about Francesca?
No, I'm not saying Francesca. No, I think that's normally someone who actually does it.
We want to keep people watching, no, as Mr. Duncan.
You're the one that's saying it, not me. Just don't say anything.
Beatrice says in Argentina it's on the left hand. It took me decades to work out which hand it was.
Yes. Anyway, just to say again, the word I just used is a very loose woman who goes after lots and lots of different men.
But of course, men go after lots of women. It's the same thing.
Well, he's not called that. He's normally called a Lothario or Lothario.
Yes, that's it. It's always a positive thing, isn't it, when a man is dating lots of women.
I don't know why, though.
It's not seen the same way when a woman does it.
Where are you going, Steve?
I'm just... Well,
you're sort of vanishing from me.
There we go. We've caught up now.
Okay.
Florence is only here for a short time. Well, don't worry, so are we.
We're all only here for a short time.
Today, so, you know, leave whenever you feel like it. It's all very flexible.
We're all here for a short time.
It's all very flexible.
On this earth. So make the most of it. You know what I did this morning? I woke up at 4 o'clock this morning. I went into the garden and all the stars were out in the sky. And I actually got one of our outdoor chairs. I sat on it for nearly 2 hours watching the stars above me, and I was watching all the little satellites going over, and I actually saw one shooting star go over, and I thought of your mum at the same time. A very lovely moment.
Because today is fortunately the anniversary of my mother's sad passing.
Unfortunately.
Unfortunately, yes. So I've been thinking about my mum a lot today. Well, last night as well, because it actually happened in the early hours of the morning. So, yes, but we decided to come on anyway because we just wanted to cheer ourselves up. And my mother said, don't cry, enjoy your life, because I've had a good one. So that's what we're doing.
Yes, well, that's what life is for, you see. I know we say this quite often, but life is for living. Live your life. Live your daily life as if it's the last one. And one day, you will be right.
Somebody's forgot to switch off the electric pad. It was covered with a blanket and started to smoke. Do you mean your iPad, Olga?
Okay.
Do you mean your... When you say electric pad, do you mean your iPad or maybe electric blanket? Oh, no, can't have been an electric blanket.
I'm enjoying your inner monologue.
Yes, thank you, Beatrice. Yes, so you saw, and I didn't see it, a shooting star.
No, Steve was fast asleep.
Well, I wasn't actually. I was awake.
I know you were fast asleep, actually. You were making all the sounds that you make when you're asleep. The whistling, the grunting, and the occasional...
What was that?
Sorry? Nothing. Nothing. I didn't say anything.
But yes, because the shooting star would have been nice to see, because it's unusual to see them probably at this time of the year. They're infrequent.
Yes. You get a lot around August.
Thank you, Rosa. And of course, I wonder how long it takes before you stop remembering about the death of a loved one every year.
Well, we're never going to forget it because your mother sadly passed 2 days after the Queen.
She did.
So every year in this country, we are always going to mention it. So we're always going to remember that. Although I have a feeling we are never going to forget her.
Well, the news didn't mention my mother. I only mentioned the Queen. I'd have thought they would have, you know, the BBC would have mentioned my mother, but no. Never mind. It was a small electric blanket. I used it to warm up my feet.
Oh, good idea.
You don't need to put an S on the end of that, Olga, because feet, plural for feet, is feet.
Mm.
You don't need to put an S on the end of feet.
You have singular, foot.
Foot.
And two, feet.
2 feet.
Because it's already assumed that there are more than one. So even if there are 12 feet, 12 pairs of feet, or 6 pairs of feet, and there are 12 actual feet, you still say feet. So once you go over one, it is feet, 1 foot.
It's unfortunately in English, it's one of those things you just have to, there's no rule around it, because normally if you're going from singular to plural, you would put an S on the end, wouldn't you?
A lot of times. There are many things in English that are not plural.
Well, for example,
if I
had a telephone.
Fish.
If there was one telephone, it's a telephone. If I had more than one telephone, you would say telephones.
Mm.
But for feet, it's 1 foot, 2 feet, or 10 feet. That you don't put an S on the end of. There is no such word as feets.
Yes.
We're just helping here, helping.
I'm not
English.
I'm not sure about that.
Teeth and tooth, there's another good one, Olga, yes.
That's it, yes. So there are many things that don't have a plural, but they do have another word that stands in for the plural.
Many teeth, 2 teeth or 3 teeth or 4 teeth.
Hmm.
But yes, there are these exceptions, aren't there?
Yes,
which you have to be aware of.
That's it.
There's no rule.
Over time, you do learn them.
You just have to learn them over time. So it's, I hope you don't mind me correcting you there. But this is an English teaching channel, after all.
Apparently.
Yes. And the numbers are kind of persons.
Yes. Persons can also be if just generally anyone, anything that might be, for example, something unknown, persons unknown, so you are not sure who it is.
Yes, but in that context, probably the normal context would be one person or many people.
Mm.
So there's another example.
Yes.
But there is a word, persons, as Mr. Duncan just explained. So that makes it even more complicated.
Also, if we are using it as something you are owning or in its possessive form, a person's income, a person's house. So in that sense, you would have the apostrophe and then S at the end to show the possessive clause.
Yes, these are just individual little words you have to know and remember, unfortunately. But there you go.
Mm.
I'm sure every language has its little idiosyncrasies, its little... I wonder if there's any language that sticks to a very rigid set of rules and you always know what to do according to the rule.
No, I can tell you that now.
Not even German. I would have thought German would have been very precise.
They all have some crazy rules. So in any language, but the most of the rules are a problem when you try to translate from one language to another. Chinese, for example, doesn't have the past tense. So that's why it's quite difficult for people who speak Chinese to learn English as a second language, because in English there is a lot of past tense that has to be remembered.
Yes. So Francesca says there, I think she means, is the word person singular or plural? I think
singular.
Singular,
so
yes.
A person, one person.
I saw a person walk by.
But you can have it as the plural, persons. So, but generally speaking, we don't use that because Well, first of all, it sounds not very good. And there is a much simpler word you can use instead. People. There were many people in the room.
What's that person doing over there?
Yes.
Would refer to one person. You don't know their name, so you would call them a person. Or you could say, what's that man doing or what's that woman doing?
Mm.
But if there were lots of people, what are all those people doing over there? Oh, they've come to see Mr. Duncan.
So generally speaking, person is one individual. Persons, quite often it is lots of people, but it isn't often used. In fact, I think in some senses it might be seen as a little archaic.
I think Mr. Steve is one of them. Do you agree? I'm definitely one of them, Beatrice. I think Beatrice was referring to Lewis's question about my mother, saying, my mother had two children. Well, as far as I know, it was just two, myself and my sister. And Lewis was asking, is my sister or am I as intrepid and courageous as your mother? I couldn't possibly answer that, but Beatrice has and says she thinks that... what does Beatrice say? I've lost it now. Beatrice said that she thought that I was. Do you agree? Well, I'm... Am I intrepid and courageous, Mr. Duncan? I would probably say yes.
I would say that you're not as adventurous as you used to be. But I think that's normal when you get older. So I'm the same. I used to be more adventurous when I was younger. But as you get older, you become a little bit more afraid to push yourself forward. I have to say, when we did the big rendezvous in Paris, I was quite nervous about doing it. It doesn't look as if I was nervous because I was having lots of fun. But up until that point, I was so nervous. I thought, what if it all goes wrong? I really felt quite worried about it.
But in the end, it was a lovely trip. And we're still in touch with all of you wonderful people that we met up with. And we were only talking about it the other day that we want to do it again next year.
Yes, well we will see what happens
there. But we must plan, Mr. Duncan, to go somewhere. A lot of people said that they wanted to have a rendezvous in the UK.
Okay.
we want to go to Italy.
Okay, Steve, all of these things are going to be taken as something we're arranging.
Nothing is arranged. I know nothing's arranged. I didn't say it was, Mr. Duncan.
Well, you are kind of listing countries now.
Well, I'm just speculating. You know, where could we go?
Yes.
I think people want to come to the UK, actually. So we may have to bow to popular pressure.
Yeah, we don't know yet. Can we just say 2024 is a long way off and people keep dying and things keep changing in the world. Who knows? We might not be here tomorrow. The house might fall down during the night and we'll be both killed.
Well, I've just been looking at the house insurance, which needs renewing, Mr. Duncan, so runs out at the end of this month. So I've been looking around for a good deal on that. Francesca wants us to go to Italy, of course, because she lives in Italy, as do many of our friends. Christina is also in Italy. So there we go, you see. We've been seeing some lovely pictures from their holidays.
Okay.
And so it's making me think that people in Italy are always on holiday.
Do you want to come back a bit? You're disappearing. Well, I don't think... You're sort of slowly going down like this.
Well, I'm leaning, Mr. Duncan. I'm leaning.
Why?
Leaning on a lamppost at the corner of the street.
Do you want a big chair to sit in?
In case a certain little lady goes by. Or man. That's a song, the line of a song, popular song from, can't remember the name of the show, Mr. Duncan. Mm-hmm. I should remember it because, I've never been in it, have I?
You're certainly in it today.
Yes, my mother did have a car accident and started to drive again. And she was 90 at the time. I think she was probably, around that age, certainly. I think she was a bit younger than that, but I mean, probably still about 80. I think she was probably 87, 88. When she had the car accident. I had a car accident when I was 22 and I went back driving again.
It's always about Mr. Steve.
I know, it was courageous. Let's have a look. I'll have a car accident when I'm 90 and let's see if I get back in. But I won't be able to tell you, unfortunately.
No, don't have a car accident.
I don't want to. It's a, you know, a minor one.
Oh, that's okay then. Oh, it's okay. Yes, Steve will just make sure that the car accident is a minor one.
You have some lovely memories because of your mother's... Yes, that's exactly. So thank you for that, Olga. Yes, Italy. So I've read that one already. That's all we've got today is the live chat because we were going to go outside further away than this. It's stopped raining now, Mr. Duncan. We could actually...
It's stopped raining. Now, Mr. Steve can't be heard. Steve's still talking and I've got the microphone. I have the microphone, you see, but the rain has stopped everyone. I'm coming back now. Don't panic.
So I was, I said, Francesca, Francesca. Is it Francesca or Francesca?
That was Francesca. It's Francesca.
If I say Francesca, is that correct?
It is correct.
Please tell us. Because there isn't a, I think there should be a H in there, because but there isn't. The C there must be pronounced as a ch sound.
Yes.
See, I haven't got my own mic, Olga. Only Mr. Duncan is in control of the sound.
Sometimes Mr. Steve is a bit of a chunt.
So he walks off and I start talking. Carry on talking, so you're making me look a bit of a fool.
I wasn't doing that. I just walked off to see if it was still raining. You're the one that carried on talking.
Is it Francesca, number one, or is it number two, Francesca?
No, it's Francesca.
One or two?
She told us when we met her.
I know, well, I've forgotten, you see.
Yes, well, I'm telling you, that's what, it's Francesca.
Is Mr. Duncan right? Please tell us. Number one.
I am right.
Which was number one? I can't remember now.
Francesca.
Right, okay. I've forgotten. Oh, my blood sugar's dropping, Mr. Duncan. I haven't eaten much today.
I'm not sure if it's your blood sugar that's dropping. Something's dropping, but it's not your blood sugar.
So the C is pronounced like a ch sound.
Yes.
Like a, we in England, the ch sound would be a CH. But obviously in Italian, the C is pronounced as a ch sound.
Yes. Like ciabatta, like that special bread.
Talking of bread, there's an interesting word for you. Chur, yes, thank you, Francesca.
Are you sure you don't want a high chair or a rocking chair?
No, I'm fine, I'm just leaning, Mr. Duncan. So we went to this restaurant and they had something on the menu called artisan bread. And they had artisan sausages. So if you see the word artisan in a sentence that's linked to food, then it often means that somebody has specially made this by hand. It's something very special about it. Some ancient technique that they've used. It means that it hasn't come out of a factory. So artisan bread, it means somebody has made it, you know, in some traditional way. Yes, it's a bit posh.
It generally means handmade or something that's been made from raw ingredients.
And inevitably will be twice the cost, at least, of normal bread. But it was revolting.
Was this yesterday's meal?
The starter was this artisan bread. Mm. It was rock hard and tasteless.
Okay.
So I was very disappointed. Of course, being artisan, as soon as you put artisan in front of something, you can double the price in the UK.
Well, normally that's because it's handmade.
It's a little pretentious to say that you've got artisan bread or artisan sausages or something like that. So if you ever see that on a menu, avoid. Mm. Avoid.
Yes.
Because you're paying twice the price and you get half the taste.
Also, avoid the Littleton Arms.
Yes. Pizza in Italy is an artisan meal. Yes. Wow, says Francesca.
Yes.
Artisan meal.
That is what I want to see, you see. That is what I want to see. One of the things that attracts me about going to Italy would be to go to a place where you are seeing all the food made from the very raw ingredients.
Traditional recipe.
Yes, from the raw ingredients. So pizza is something you rarely see made from the raw ingredients, especially when you make a telephone call and it's delivered to your house. So you never see how it's made.
Very true, Mr. Duncan. We'd love to come to Italy and sample. See, my favourite Italian food, I do like a calzone. Or is it calzone or calzoni? It's a sort of a folded bread with a filling. Hot, delicious. It's a bit like a sort of a pizza, but folded over.
Yeah, that's, and a bit smaller. That's basically what it is.
And you put some nice hot filling in meatballs or vegetables or cheese or something. Do you pronounce the E? Is it calzone or just calzone? It's probably calzone. So number one, calzone. Number two, calzone.
See, I've heard it pronounced both ways.
I have. So is it one or two? Francesca, please tell us. We're paying a lot of attention to Francesca today, of course. Oh, it's number two. Ah. Oh, it's number two, says Christina.
Okay.
VI, or is that six? Calzone, says Francesca. Oh, calzone. Ah, so Christina's saying you do pronounce the E. And
yes, as I just said, there are different ways probably of saying it, because I've heard it pronounced in different ways.
Yes, I have.
It's a bit like often and often. Some people say often, some people say often. You see? Yes. So that's in English.
Because normally in Italy, we would normally think that every letter has to be pronounced, is what we are sort of taught as a rule for Italian. So however you see the word spelt, you have to pronounce each consonant, each vowel.
Well, that's wrong. Whoever's teaching Italian is not a very good Italian teacher.
I think that's a sort of a rule. If you're in doubt, pronounce everything. Well, that's what you're taught in singing anyway.
In fact, I always find the Italian language, there are many words or phrases that are pronounced not as they appear written. It's very interesting. Whereas in English, at least in English, we do have silent letters. So I think that's the worst part of learning English. You have to get used to all of the silent letters.
Oh, there's a good question, Rosa. Which culinary in the world has influenced England?
Well, every single one?
Every single one. I would say there is an influence from everywhere in England. But if you were to talk specifically for more recent times, I would say Indian culture has had a massive impact on English cuisine.
Mm.
Because you will go to any restaurant now, even that one we went to, which was what you would call a traditional English sort of restaurant, there's always a curry option on there now, where you go to any restaurant, because somebody always wants some kind of curry. Even if it's not an Indian restaurant, wherever you go, there'll be some kind of curry dish in there as well. So I think probably I would say that is been a big influence over the last sort of 40 years in the UK.
But I also from many of the invasions that have taken place over the years. So we kind of steal all of the good bits from all the people that come here to invade us, or people who come to visit. So we are very good here at borrowing other people's cultural delights, and food is probably the top one.
I would say as well, apart from curry, the Italian influence has been very strong. Lots of people, pizzas are very common.
Mm.
Pizza, spaghetti, when I grew up, my father was always cooking spaghetti bolognese. He loved Italian food. So I think that's stuck, hasn't it? So I think from the sort of 50s, 60s and 70s, I think Italian was the big influence. And that has stayed and Indian has come in. Probably Italians, probably more, would you say, Mr. Duncan?
You might actually find, and this is the weird part, you might find a lot of the food influences over the past 50 years have actually come from the United States. So Italian food became very popular in the United States because they had a lot of Italian migrants. And the same thing with other cultures and other nationalities. But it's very strange. I think it's fair to say that all cultures actually influence each other in some way. If you look at Asian culture, you will find a lot of things that are done maybe in Japanese culture originated in Chinese culture. And some things that originated in Chinese culture actually originated in Indian culture. So everyone, we all do it, we all borrow the tasty parts of each other's cultures. I think so.
I mean, we French, I would say, yes, I mean, that's a good point you've made there. I mean, American influence with, I mean, you look at the number of McDonald's there are everywhere. Kentucky Fried Chicken, KFC, that is, you know, if you were going to look at what, if you'd add up what proportion of different food people eat from different cultures, I bet, particularly in young people, I bet the American burger influence is probably greater. But if you're talking about going out to a restaurant to have a meal in the evening somewhere, then the curries are very popular. Chinese, of course, is. But you don't really see Chinese outside a Chinese restaurant very much, do you? I mean, you can buy Chinese food. People don't sort of cook Chinese food very much at home, but they might cook a curry because it's easy to cook. You just got a sauce in a jar.
Well, noodles, Chinese food is actually quite popular because it's quick to make. You can actually make a stir fry in just a few seconds. So that's
pot noodles are a very common junk food, aren't they, Mr. Duncan? Pots among students.
Noodles are seen quite often as something that is convenient, ramen. I'm sure you've heard of that, Steve. And it's something that many students eat because it's very quick to make. In fact, all you need is boiling water. Sometimes you can add your own ingredients. So ramen is a type of, it looks like a noodle, but it's very easy to make, very convenient.
Yes, Spanish. We there's an influence of Spanish here as well. It's everything. We haven't really got, apart from fish and chips and roast beef. You would say they were typical English foods. Fish and chips and roast beef.
But I think you will even find that things like fish and chips are actually borrowed from other cultures. So I don't think we have any what you would call traditional food. Turnips, boiled turnips, I think that's it. And maybe some boiled potatoes. That's all we used to eat. But then all of this beautiful food came to us from lots of other countries, and now we have all sorts of delicious things. But I think even fish and chips, it isn't originally English.
Well, probably spaghetti isn't originally Italian. We don't really know, but here we go. What about Vietnamese food? Yes, well, we have Vietnamese restaurants here. I don't know if you've had Vietnamese food.
There is a nice Vietnamese restaurant in London. I saw it. Unfortunately, it was closed the other week when I went down to London. It was closed, but I looked at the menu and a lot of the stuff on there look delicious, but I don't think I've ever tried Vietnamese food.
I'm showing my ignorance here. I would associate that as being close to Chinese, but I might be wrong. It's probably, I would think rice, lots of rice. I don't know. Don't look like that, Mr. Duncan.
I'm just listening.
I'm asking the question.
Yes, I'm just listening.
But we do have Vietnamese restaurants in the UK, but not many, I would say.
I've never tried what you would call Vietnamese food, but I Malaysian food, quite often, if you go to Malaysia and have some of the finest food in the world, a place called Penang in Malaysia, their food, their street food is very, well known, but again, it's influenced by many different cultures.
There we go, Christina VI. It's gone now. Lasagna. Well, lasagna is a very popular dish to make at home. It's an easy one to make for food companies to put into packages, and you just heat it up. See, what we love in the UK, probably in a lot of countries now, is food that is quick and easy to make. So if it's quick and easy to make, we love it. So lasagna is great because the companies can make it, put it in a tin foil, and you just heat it up when you're in the oven.
Mm.
So anything that's quick and easy to do, pot noodles, very quick and easy to do. It's junk food, pizzas, just stick them in the oven, easy to do. So anything like that, Mr. Duncan, we love here in the UK. And anyone who is at work and doesn't have very much time. Boiled potatoes. yes, exactly, came from South America. So boiled potatoes, of course, are associated with the Irish.
Well, that's why I mentioned turnips first, because that's basically all people ate. And anything they could catch that didn't run very fast.
Well, it's the same in any country. What you would have eaten, you know, hundreds of years ago would have been what was available in your country, what grew, what vegetables grew, what animals were there.
Mm.
So lamb probably has been popular in the UK. I don't know when they started, when lamb became a particular animal that was reared on farms. I don't know when that started.
Well, I think that's once again, I think that's Northern Europe. I think having livestock took a while to catch on here. Certain cows didn't exist. Frisian cows, often used for producing milk, aren't actually native to this country.
Blinken, who is the American Secretary of State, something like that, at MC Fried Chips in Kiev. What's MC, McDonald's?
I don't know. I can't see the message.
MC Fried Chips in Kiev. There we go. Yes, it's probably a fast food restaurant, which, of course, they've got them everywhere. Lasagna with meat or vegetables. Yeah, so whatever would have been available, people would have eaten in the UK. But it probably would have been less than what would have been available in a hotter country. But, I mean, wheat, of course, anything wheat-based, because wheat's been around for thousands and thousands of years. Everyone grows wheat now, don't they? So that would have, anything that's wheat-based, bread.
I always find it interesting that only certain countries produce a lot of the grain for the rest of the world. Of course, at the moment, we're talking a lot about Ukraine. Ukraine produces a lot of grain that is then exported to different countries.
Yeah.
And you find also other countries that produce more of a certain type of food than you actually realise.
There we go. Potatoes, yes, Olga, associated with Ireland. I don't know if whether they eat a lot of potatoes now. Probably not, because they had that famous and tragic famine when potato blight, which is a fungus that destroys potato crops, devastated Ireland, and there a lot of people starved to death because it was like a staple. If something's a staple, it's a main part of your diet, an important main part. So that's where they were getting a lot of their energy from. And there was this potato famine in probably the 18 somethings. I don't know when it was. My history isn't too good. But we didn't help them out. They didn't like us, did they? Because I don't think we gave them much aid at the time.
Well, it was a long-standing dispute that was still continuing and is continuing to this very day.
Everyone's hungry now, Mr. Duncan, because as usual, we're talking about food. And it's almost lunchtime in Brazil. So Johannes Martins, what are you going to be eating then? If it's almost lunchtime, what are you going to be eating in Brazil? Please tell us. We'd love to know.
What gives us milk? I don't even know what we're eating today. We might have beans on toast. See, there is a very popular meal that people like to eat here in the UK. Beans on toast. Oh, I like it very much.
Claudia's been tossing pancakes and making cannelloni. Cannelloni. That's a difficult word to pronounce. Which, of course, is pasta. And pasta, of course, is made from wheat.
Mm.
And everyone grows wheat. So lots of different varieties of food made from wheat.
Yeah, wheat and rice.
Wheat and rice. We eat a lot of rice. Maybe a couple of times a week we have rice. And when I grew up, we had rice. My mother would buy a Vesta curry, which was a curry. Because my dad was a sailor and he used to travel around the world. So he had a very varied palate. He ate lots of different foods.
Didn't that come in a box?
Yes. So my father loved food from different countries, particularly French food. And he used to cook. He was quite a good cook. And he'd always add lots of garlic and herbs into food. My mother didn't like garlic. It gave her a stomach ache, but Dad always put lots of garlic in food because that was, you know, French cuisine always has lots of garlic in it. So we had quite a varied diet when we grew up because Dad used to travel the world. He's in the Merchant Navy. So he sampled all these different foods and I think gave my mum a bit of an education. Brussels sprouts, of course.
It certainly taught her a lesson.
There's another food people associate with the UK and England is Brussels sprouts, cabbages.
But but ironically, they are also European.
That's it, but they grow very well here in these sort of cold countries. It means, see, Brussels sprouts means you can have a vegetable during the winter because obviously normally vegetables don't survive the winter climate,
They are very hardy.
Brussels sprouts survive all the frost and you can take them off, you know, before Christmas and you've got a healthy vegetable to last you through the winter months. That's why turnips are popular because they survive over the winter months.
Can I just say we don't eat turnips anymore here in the UK? It was a traditional meal during medieval times, but not now.
Greetings from Peru, says Juan Bernard. Greetings to you too.
Hello, Juan.
You're here.
Hello, Juan.
We have so many people that watch us in the South American continent. And it's Argentina, Brazil, Peru. It's lovely to have you here. We've stayed a lot longer than we thought we were going to.
Colombia as well. We have a lot of viewers in Colombia. You might not realise that, but we do. We do. A lot of people in Colombia.
Yes, happy birthday to Claudia's brother. We won't ask how old he is. We can ask. We can ask. You might not want to tell us, though. Patrick's here.
Can I just ask how Beatrice's brother is? How is your brother, Beatrice? Is he doing okay? I hope he is.
Hello, Marcia as well. Lots of delicious food in Argentina. See, there's a country we ought to visit. Cheese, bread, different types of wine. But yes, South American food always sounds very exotic to me. Peas. Yes, well, we eat a lot of peas. It's a very popular vegetable, again, because it's very easy to prepare. You just take it out of the freezer and put it in some boiling water.
Yes. You can grow your own, of course, which is very satisfying because then you can take the peas out of the pod and you can pop them open. I like that.
My father used to grow all his own vegetables, or most of them, carrots, peas, broad beans, huge quantities. He always grew far too much. We ended up eating it for months. He used to freeze it, put it in the deep freeze.
I can't imagine broad beans frozen.
They're not very nice when they're fresh.
That is disgusting.
Broad beans are not one of my favourite vegetables. They're all right when they're very new, but when they start getting bigger and bigger, they get very hard and they're difficult to cook. But yes, my father was very excited because one day he bought a deep freeze and we used to freeze everything in the garden, but they never used to freeze that well. Beans froze quite well. Runner beans.
Most vegetables don't freeze very well. You can't freeze potatoes. you can't freeze eggs. Have you ever tried freezing an egg? Apparently it explodes because it expands as it freezes.
Yes, peas, of course, freeze very well. I think anything that's got a low water content will freeze well. So peas freeze well. But the trouble is when you freeze things like... you lose a lot of the nutrients because when you cook it, all the nutrients come out because it's broken all the cells open. So I don't think when you freeze vegetables and then cook them, unless you steam them, you're going to lose a lot of the nutrients. My brother is having a great recovery, but he needs to control his food.
Oh, well, that's interesting. That is interesting. One of my biggest fears, can I just let you in on my own personal life, the things that go on inside this weird thing in here? One of my biggest fears is not being able to eat certain types of food. I would hate it so much if I ever got diabetes. If I ever became diabetic, I think I would just jump off the nearest building.
Yeah, but...
Because I wouldn't be able to...
You like sugar.
Yeah, well, that's the point.
Sugar is... you're a bit of a sugar addict.
I love sweet things. Chocolate, sweets, cakes, anything. Even sugar. Just... I could just eat sugar. Just...
It'll just have to be turnips for you, Mr. Duncan.
Turnips.
Vegetables would be fine. But yes, you would have to severely moderate your intake of refined sugars.
So that is a very good incentive for me to actually stay fairly healthy, because I don't want to actually end up with some sort of illness that means I can't eat all of my favourite food.
Trum Ong, I think it's Trum Ong, I can't quite... Can you read that, Mr. Duncan? Asks.
Trum Ong, what type of food is popular for vegetarians in the UK? Mm. Well, first of all, vegetarians have kind of become the dominant force when we talk about food politics. So when we talk about politics connected to food, I would say that the most politically vocal of all of the groups must be vegetarians, getting people to eat less meat. But of course, the main reason is to stop the animals from being slaughtered. But of course, if we didn't have the animals for slaughtering, they wouldn't exist at all. So that's the irony. It's a bit of a paradox, really. But there are lots of things, aren't there? Lots of vegetarian meals.
If you're going to a restaurant, vegetable lasagna is a very popular vegetarian dish. It's easy for the restaurant to make, and it's also quite tasty. You've got to be careful, of course, being a vegetarian, that you don't get deficient. It's much more difficult to be a healthy vegetarian, probably, they say, than to be a healthy meat eater or an omnivore, somebody that eats a wide variety of foods, which, of course, you only have to look at our teeth to know that sort of ecologically and evolutionary, we are omnivores wide variety.
Yeah, so what about vegetarian meals then? So there's lasagna.
There's lasagna.
And of course there's fruit and vegetables.
Rice, anything with rice in and vegetables. It depends on what type of vegetarian you are. Some will eat eggs, which is a good source of protein. But if you're vegan, you're going to have a problem with... anything that comes has been anywhere near an animal.
Yes.
Of course, the thing is, you can switch to a vegetarian diet or a vegan diet and feel very healthy for a long time, because it takes a long time for certain vitamins and minerals to become deficient. It can take years. Vitamin B12 is a common one that vegetarians suffer from a deficiency, because there are only certain foods where you can get that particular vitamin from. Eggs being one of them.
I must admit, whenever anyone tells me that they're vegetarian or vegan, you can normally tell anyway before they even say it, because they look quite unhealthy. That's the irony. I don't think I've ever met anyone who is a vegan who doesn't actually look unhealthy, which is ironic when you think about it.
I mean, they used to say that if you're vegetarian, if you look at the statistics, you're more likely to live longer. I don't think it's by very much, but I think if you, on balance, vegetarians probably live a bit longer. But that's probably the vegetarians that are very careful about what they eat to make sure that they are getting a healthy diet. These days, people often turn vegetarian or vegan, and because they're rushing around, they're busy with work, they're buying the easy to cook pre-packaged foods from supermarkets, which have got a very low level of vitamins and minerals in them. So that's the danger. You can switch to these diets if you want to. You can become vegetarian, but you've got to know what you're doing to remain healthy.
So you've got to keep all of the supplements to make sure that all of those vitamins are still going into your body.
You do need to have supplements, you're right.
Or else your bones will turn to rubber and all your teeth will fall out. You might even go blind.
But you don't notice that because it's a gradual... Your body can store certain vitamins, but it takes many years sometimes for your stores to deplete to a level that you will show symptoms of deficiency.
Well, somebody died recently, a well-known YouTube celebrity, and she was someone who was just eating vegetables and fruit, and she became so thin and unhealthy, her body just gave up. So I think that just proves the point.
Yes, you can be very, very healthy vegetarian, a very, very healthy vegan, but you've got to know what you're doing. You can't just... Whereas you can... If you eat a wide variety of foods, including meat, then you're likely to remain healthier because you're getting all the variety. The trouble with humans is we need to have a big, wide variety of foods to get all the nutrients we need. Some animals can make vitamins within their own body, but we can't. We don't have very many vitamins inside us, whereas animals do. That's why, you know, dogs don't need to eat vegetables, for example. We do, because we can't make vitamin C.
Even though now there is a trend to give dogs carrots and peas, apparently. That's the big thing. A lot of dog food now has vegetables in them, even though... Well, as you rightly said, Steve, they don't really need it, but it's very trendy, you see. It's very trendy and sophisticated.
Of course, there's always some new fad popular diet coming along. The common one now is meat eaters, carnivore diet. That's a common one now, which I'm sure for a period of time will help you lose weight. And it's probably very good for you. But there's no real evidence that on the long term is going to be good for you.
I think too much of anything is bad for you. You can have too much fruit, too many vegetables.
You've got to have some protein.
Everything in moderation.
We're omnivores. You've just got to, it's common sense. You need to eat a wide variety of food.
Yeah.
Probably is the safest thing if you want to remain healthy. In the long term.
I like meat. I like vegetables, I like fruit, I like sweet things. So maybe I am the more typical human being in that respect.
Lovely. So we love talking about food, don't we? I mean, don't take any of my advice seriously. I'm no expert.
I love eating food more than talking about it.
Which we will be doing as soon as we come off this live stream. I'll be having some lovely bread, which I baked yesterday.
In the machine.
Would you call what I baked artisan bread, Mr. Duncan?
No.
No, because it was done in a machine. I didn't use my fingers and I didn't knead the dough. It's a nice feeling, kneading dough.
Mm.
When I say kneading, and that's K-N, kneading is an action of manipulating the dough. But if you knead something, if you need, you smell, you need a bath, that means you, it's something that you have to do. That's N-E-E-D. We're talking about, thank you, Christina, that is correct spelling of kneading. So you're manipulating with your hands some bread dough, Would you manipulate anything else with your hands and call it kneading, or is it just referred to when you're making bread, do you think?
I don't know, maybe if you're having a very deep massage, maybe they will knead your muscles with their hands.
Yes.
They will manipulate your muscles and other parts of your body as well.
Thanks for that. Knead your buttocks. Somebody might knead your buttocks. Well, they might knead them, N-E-E-D as well. They might actually knead them for other reasons. But there we go, Beatrice. If you are doing that to your bread dough, you are kneading it, manipulating it physically.
Talking of happy endings, we will be going in a few moments. So we are coming towards the end of this live stream. We've been with you now for 1 hour and 11 minutes, a lot longer than we anticipated. And the rain has stopped, you may notice. In fact, let's just go over here, Steve, for a moment. Let's just come and admire the view and the fact that the rain has stopped. Everything is all right. Where are you? Where are you, Steve?
So I'm here.
Isn't it lovely?
It's very humid, Mr. Duncan, very humid. Patrick, by the way, I just want to mention Patrick.
Hello, Patrick.
Hello, Patrick. Grows a lot of vegetables in his garden. I think he just said on the live chat that his tomatoes are ready.
Oh.
They're nice and red and ready for picking.
I do love the smell. If you have one of those greenhouses, made of glass and you are growing tomatoes, I love that smell when you open the door and you go in and all of the tomatoes are ripe and there's that delicious sweet smell in the air, and it's all warm and humid inside the greenhouse. I love that feeling. I don't know why.
Yes, when you buy tomatoes from the supermarket, they often don't have that smell of homegrown tomatoes.
Mm.
So, Patrick, do your tomatoes smell like tomatoes? I'm sure they do.
And if
they're walking back,
if they don't,
casual way.
If they don't smell like tomatoes, please tell us what they smell like.
There we go. So yes, I'd like to taste your vegetables, Patrick.
Steve, I can't.
What?
We need the microphone.
Okay. Fine. Lovely. Yes. How lovely. Yes. So, yeah, maybe you could show us a picture of your vegetables.
there's an offer.
It's not a euphemism.
Can we see your vegetables, Patrick? Can you get them out for us?
Patrick's been taking a lot of holidays, but then he is retired. That's something I'm missing going back to work, is being able to do what I want
and nobody,
whenever I want to do it.
Nobody made you go back to work.
No, I voluntarily went back.
Well,
voluntarily went back, is that right?
Yes. You went back to work, but he's certainly not doing it voluntarily.
I've sort of... Anyway, right. Is that it then, Mr. Duncan? Are we off?
It seems like Mr. Steve wants to go.
It seems like people think we are going and they're also going.
Okay, then.
Or maybe not.
Maybe not. Maybe they are, maybe they're not. This is the wonderful thing about doing a live stream. Sometimes you can go on for a long time, and sometimes you can just do it for a couple of minutes. By the way, if you missed yesterday's video that we recorded in the car, it is a little bit crazy. And Mr. Steve actually sounds his horn. I can't believe he did that. I really can't.
Patrick's got no melons, but he's got buns. Is that, will you make a pumpkin pie?
Mm.
Patrick, will you cut out the pumpkin and make it into a Halloween, that is pumpkins, isn't it? You cut out, make a face and put a light inside.
I like pumpkin pie, or you can have, I think you can have pumpkin stew as well.
Probably very good for you.
Very nice.
Wide variety of food, that's what you need to stay healthy. What are we having tonight, Mr. Duncan, to eat?
Beans on toast.
I might make something Italian tonight. Out of a jar, of course.
Beans on toast on pizza.
I think we might have. I call it. We'll have tuna, with pasta sauce on rice tonight, Mr. Duncan. And I always put in some cooked, what's that vegetable I put in? Spinach. And some herbs and some garlic. I can get it done in under half an hour.
Okay, that's good. So we are having an Italian meal tonight. Mr. Steve will be making it. I was going to make the beans on toast, but Steve wants to make the meal instead, so there we go.
We need something a bit more substantial.
Well, we had a massive meal yesterday, even though it was disgusting.
If you have a substantial meal, it means that it's a big meal. There's a lot to it. Nutritious, good for you.
Okay.
A substantial meal. Anything that's substantial means there's a lot of it, doesn't it?
That's it.
Is that correct?
You can have a substantial amount of money. You can have a substantial gain or a substantial loss.
We don't want that, Mr. Duncan.
By the way, new lessons this week. New recorded lessons coming up on my YouTube channel before we go. I will let you know about that. So that's it. Let's go, Mr. Steve. Shall we go?
Yes. I'm going to have some yoghurt and bread.
Oh, that sounds good.
Greek yoghurt I'm going to be having. Low-fat Greek yoghurt.
Good. Sounds good to me.
I have that virtually every day.
Yeah.
Nice. I put some homemade damson jam in it and some raisins. Lovely.
I can't say I like the sound
I've enjoyed it today, Mr. Duncan.
Good. I hope it's taken your mind off other sad things.
Yes, it has. I think my mother would be pleased that we're carrying on as normal.
I think that's what she would have wanted.
Yes. So that's what we're doing.
So that is it. We are going. Thank you for watching. See you very soon. We are back next Sunday, I think, live from 2 p.m.
All being well, as we say.
All being well, as long as nothing happens to the house tonight. I don't know why it would. Thank you very much for your company. See you soon. And yes, there will be some new lessons during the week. I will tell you again, new lessons will be published during the week. We have some interesting topics and also some very good advice coming up next week. See you later. On behalf of myself and also
Mr. Steve, been lovely to have your company this afternoon.
Thank you for watching. See you soon. And of course, until the next time we meet, you know what's coming next. Yes, you do.
Ta-ta for now.